Yo, MVP, let's go.
All of my life, I've never known you to fail. You remain the same man. Wonderful is your name. All of my life, I've never known you to fail. You remain the same, and wonderful is your name.
Jesus. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm Pastor Brandon Clay, and I want to welcome you to the Cyber Sanctuary of the Main Street Church of God in Christ in this year's virtual fall in-house revival. We've had several weeks of groundbreaking worship and word, and tonight will be no different. We thank God for all of you taking the time out of your day to worship with us. We know that there's so many other places that you can be. There's so many things going on the internet even right now. So we thank you for taking time to join with us in worship tonight, and we thank you for your prayers. Tonight we have a very special treat for you, and that we will hear from none other than Main Street's own Minister Joy Clemens Branch. She came to us a couple of years ago, and she has proven to us to be a teacher and a preacher par excellence. And tonight we're going to share her gift with the rest of the world. But before we go into the sanctuary tonight, let us pray. Dear eternal God, our Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy toward us, for being who you are to us. We thank you for allowing us to come together tonight in this cyberspace to worship your holy name. So Lord, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would anoint the worship, that you would anoint the word, and everyone watching even on tonight, so that we may be built up and be better as a result of this worship experience tonight. Revive us, renew us, and restore us. And we count it as done. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen.
In whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge? And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. For though I be absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in the spirit, joying and beholding our order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. Amen.
For this time in your word, we thank you just for being God. God, we ask that your anointing fill the place. Fill the room, oh God. Send the kind of anointing that causes preaching to be easy. Send the kind of anointing that causes people to be delivered. Send the kind of anointing that causes people to be set free. Father, I'm your mouthpiece. I ask that you use me like never before. In Jesus' name, amen. Tonight we are going to be coming from Joshua, the third chapter. Joshua 3. Starting in verse 14. And the subject that we're going to be using today is crossing your Jordan. Crossing your Jordan. Joshua 3, 14 through 17, starting in verse 14, it reads as follows. And it says, and it came to pass when the people removed from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the people, and as they that bear the ark were coming to Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water. For Jordan overfloweth all his banks all the time of harvest. That the waters which came down from above stood and rose up above upon an heap very far from the city Adam, that is beside Zaratan. And those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea failed and were cut off. And the people passed over right against Jericho. And the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan. And all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over Jordan. Again, verse 17, and the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan. And all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over Jordan. Once again, we are talking about crossing your Jordan. Your next dimension of glory is usually on the other side of your Jordan. Jacob had a staff in his hands when he had to cross over Jordan. He later testified in Genesis 32 and 10. He said, I only had a staff with me, but when I crossed over Jordan, I then had two bands. There are things you cannot have or access until you cross your Jordan. Man and woman of God, there are dimensions in ministry you cannot access until you cross your Jordan. If there are business persons watching, there are dimensions in the business world that you cannot cross into until you cross over your Jordan. As a couple, there are dimensions of joy in marriage that you cannot experience until you both cross over your Jordan. If there are singers or psalmists watching, there are dimensions in the music ministry that you cannot get into until you cross over your Jordan. It is important for you to understand that your Jordan is not my Jordan. A husband and wife will both have to cross their individual Jordans and cross their corporate Jordans as a couple. Naaman, a captain of the army in Syria, a mighty man. The Bible made us understand that he had leprosy. Even though he was a very mighty man, successful in the military, commander of the army, but he was a leper. Bible says that he had to dip himself seven times in the Jordan. It was then that his flesh became clean. Elijah could not be translated into the higher dimensions of ministry in the eternal realms until he crossed over Jordan. Elisha did not start his ministry after he had received the mantle until he crossed Jordan. Until only then did Elijah move in a greater dimension of his own ministry. Jesus, your Lord and my Lord, your Savior and my Savior. Jesus did not begin his ministry until he himself had to go over to Jordan. The heavens over him were not open until he came out of Jordan. You see, it is not about getting into it. It's about coming out of it or going over it. For as long as you contend with Jordan, the glory that you desire to see will not be made evident until you deal with Jordan in itself. What is Jordan? I want to deal with Jordan from a metaphorical point of view. What is Jordan? Historically speaking, Jordan is a place very close to Jericho. Geographically speaking, that is the situation. But as we look at it from a revelatory point of view, we see that Jericho, which is in close proximity to Jordan, is a place that God has promised them, the beginning of the promised land. But they cannot access that until after they deal with Jordan. So Jordan is symbolic of anything or any individual that acts as a barrier between you and the prophetic destiny that God has prepared for you. Whatever is keeping you from being optimized, whatever is keeping your gift from being maximized, whatever is causing your prophetic destiny not to find full expression, that in itself has to be confronted and conquered. Otherwise, that which you seek may not become a reality on the occasion of a Jordan you won't confront. Churches have their Jordans. Individuals have their Jordans. Families have their Jordans. Jordan is any process you must go through and come out of in order for you to get to where God is taking you. Jordan is any situation that you must cross to get over to your other side of glory. If you want to move in the realms of miracles, signs, and wonders, Jordan is something you must conquer. In summary, Jordan is anything or anyone that is standing between you and your next level in God. The Bible says that in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. Some things have to die in order for us to see what we need to see. Just follow me. Just lay some foundation. As we look at the children of Israel, after several years of wandering around in the wilderness, after numerous wars they had to fight, they have seen miracles. They wake up in the morning and manna just comes from heaven. The atmosphere has been created for that to happen. Moses plowed the ground. On the account of the relationship between Moses and God, Israel began to enjoy miracles. Bitter waters would turn into sweet water. Rocks would pour forth water. Amazing things were happening. They became used to it, to the point where the Bible says they began to question the outcome of the miracle. So much so that when they see manna, it is not the name of a food, it is a question. What is this? Little did they know that all the miracles that God was performing was not an end in itself, but a means to an end. They did not know that every time they see someone come to testify about the mighty move of God in their midst, they did not know that was only preparing them to get to understanding more about who the Almighty is, the nature of God, the attributes of God. He was exposing himself to them by the things he was doing. He was making them understand who he was. The reason why he was giving them these classes is because there was going to be a moment where they would have to be examined. They were going to come to a moment in their journey with God where everything they had seen God do would have to be brought back in order for them to confront the challenge that was going to be before them. So finally, they came over to this moment. This moment was Jordan. And now God expects of them to remember all the miracles he has done. You are now before Jordan, the most significant moment of your life. You will either have to stay on this side for the rest of your life or cross over this thing and move into your prophetic destiny. Here you have a situation where Jordan had to be crossed. The promise of God is on the other side of Jordan. The prophecy is on the other side of Jordan. What God showed you is on the other side of Jordan. Churches before the Jordan is different than church across the Jordan. Business before the Jordan is different than business across the Jordan. Family life before the Jordan is different than family life across the Jordan. Ministry before the Jordan is different than ministry across the Jordan. On the other side of the Jordan, there is no room for complacency. It is exciting to hear that the church is crossing over this Jordan to the other side. But again, for those on this side, what I'm saying is, it is now time to ask ourselves the question, am I going to be suitable or am I going to be able to fit into the church and cross the Jordan, or am I just okay for the church before the Jordan? The leaders before the Jordan, only two of them made it over to the other side of Jordan. Why? Because they were not developed in their capacity for the future of the church. They were only getting themselves in a position. They were only doing things that were relevant for what the church was. Cross over your Jordan. If you are going to cross over this Jordan, you cannot cross over with the type of skill sets you have. You cannot cross over doing business the way you used to do business. Things have to change. The apostles got to that point in Acts 6 when all of a sudden they realized so many people were coming into the church, and Peter said, look, we can't do ministry the way we used to do ministry. Cross over this Jordan. The Bible says in Joshua 1, 10 and 11, then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, pass through the host and command the people, saying, prepare you victuals. For within 3 days you shall pass over this Jordan to go in to possess the land which the Lord your God giveth you to possess it. The scripture says this Jordan. It is important to understand which of the Jordans is keeping you from maximizing your potential. What is keeping me from becoming the best that God wants me to be? I need to find it and I need to deal with it. Time is running out. Generations are waiting on you. You cannot procrastinate when people are crying for you. You talked about it. You talked about doing it when you were 20. Now you're 30. You talked about it when you were 30. Now you're 40. You talked about doing it when you were 40. Now you're 50. When will you cross this Jordan? We all come to church, and sometimes if we are not careful, church can be where we get our high. When I feel low, I just come to church and get a high, and then I go and do nothing with what I've gotten. And then I wait again for another Sunday for another dose. So the pressure is on the man of God to do something so I can feel high and go home, do nothing, come back, put the praise team under pressure to make me feel high. Then I go home, do nothing, and then I come back and go home and do nothing, and I'm putting pressure on the stage to make sure they fix me. The question is, what is your Jordan? Your Jordan may not be someone else's Jordan. Paul said, all things are lawful for me, but all things are not expedient. It may not be something that is legally wrong, but when it comes to the demands on your assignment, it may not be helpful. Every calling has a demand. Every assignment has a demand. The Levitical consecration is in dimensions. As an average member of the Levites, it's okay to get married. That's why Aaron had children. He was married. When you come over to the Levitical order after the order of the Nazarenes, things are different. They are consecrated wholly unto God. There are certain things that ordinary Levites do that Nazarites can't do. Because I see all the Christians doing it, I'm not going to do it, because our callings are not the same. The reason you are not maximizing your potential, maximizing your calling, is because you are trying to live like every other person, as though their assignment is similar to yours. Have you ever heard of a woman called Anna? How that because of the man that was on her life, she decided to not be married after her husband passed. She decided to stay single until the day she met with Jesus, because the calling requires that she intercedes until the Messiah comes. Other women were getting married, but she must not, because that is the Jordan she must cross. God is calling us individually to cross over our individual Jordan. It's important for you to sit down and ask yourself, what's my Jordan? It's not that God does not want to use you. It's just that you don't want to confront the Jordan that you will get over to the other side. In fact, in reality, God has been waiting for you on this side to cross this Jordan. It does not have to be big. It is the little foxes that spoil our vine. The problem sometimes with the Jordans you have to cross is that they are Jordans that you like. What do you do with the Jordan you drink from? What do you do with a Jordan that refreshes you? What do you do with a Jordan that comforts you? What do you do with the Jordan you have leaned on? Sometimes the greatest grace God has to give some of us is the grace to say goodbye. It is not the easiest thing to do to look at Hagar with your son Ishmael and kiss them goodbye. If you don't let them go, you won't step into your prophetic destiny in God. Let Ishmael go. What do you do with the Jordan that comforts you? You need to cross whatever your Jordan is. In Joshua 3:14, the Bible says, and it came to pass when the people were moved from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests buried the Ark of the Covenant before the people. At this point in time, the people of Israel had already built tents in the face of Jordan, because to them, we can't cross this. This is as far as we can go. So they built tents around their limitations. God had to wake them up. He said, get ready, you are crossing over the Jordan. You are building a tent around. You are more than this. You are greater than this. You are bigger than this. Don't build a tent around this side of Jordan. There is a promised prophetic destiny on the other side. God says, I have not changed my mind. What I told you years ago, I have not changed my mind. The thing that I showed you, I've not changed my mind. Who I said you would become, I have not changed my mind. Don't build your tents around your limitations. Don't build your tents around your inadequacies. Don't build your tents around your insufficiencies. You are greater than what you have accepted to be your status. You are greater than what you have accepted to be your limit. You are greater than what you have accepted to be your final point of view. Don't build your tents around your past. Don't build your tents around your failures. Don't build your tents around your mistakes. Don't build your tents around your limitations. Don't camp around your past. Don't camp around the words of men. Don't camp around what people say about you. Don't camp around what you perceive about yourself. Don't camp around it. Don't build a tent around it. Don't stay there. You have to move. We have to get ready to cross over this Jordan. Joshua 3:15-17, and as they bear the ark that were come unto Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for Jordan overfloweth all his banks all the time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city Adam that is beside Zeratan. And those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea failed and were cut off. And the people passed over right against Jericho. And the priests that bare the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan. And all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over Jordan. There is an anointing for crossover. God said that it is time to cross over this Jordan. See the Jordan you are crossing over. See it in your spirit. God, I receive the crossover anointing. and I'm crossing over this Jordan. This Jordan of psychological barriers. This Jordan of mental barriers. This Jordan of emotional barriers. In the name of Jesus, I cross over this barrier. I'm crossing this thing that has always told me to go back. I'm crossing this thing that has always told me I was not ready. I'm crossing over this thing that has always told me I was not qualified. I'm crossing this Jordan. I release grace upon you. You are crossing over. You are crossing over from death to life. You are crossing over from borrowing into lending. You are crossing over from sorrow to joy. You are crossing over from prayerlessness to a powerful prayer life. It's my crossover season. There should no longer be a Jordan that will stand before me to hinder me like it hinders others. Cross your Jordan now. There's no takeover without crossover. Cross your Jordan. How do you cross your Jordan? If you look at the scripture in verse 15 of the text, the Bible says, and they that bear the ark will come unto Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for Jordan overfloweth all its banks all the time of harvest. Take note of this. If you are going to cross over your Jordan, number one, the Bible says that the priests who will put their feet in the water must bear the ark. The ark is symbolic of the presence of God. What this tells you is that you can't deal with your Jordan by your strength. If that were possible, you would have done that long before now. You must bear the ark of God. You must carry the presence of God. There is something about the presence of the Lord. You can't cross over your Jordan in your own strength. Two, dip your feet in your Jordan. You should not have the presence of God and do nothing with it. So many carry the presence of God and the community next to you doesn't feel the impact at all because we will not dip our feet into the Jordan. As a church, if we are going to cross over this Jordan, we need to do something. It's time to put our feet in the water. Lastly, the Bible says that they didn't just dip their feet in the water. The Bible says they stood firm on dry ground until everyone was passed over. Can you break open the path for others to come through? Can you make a sacrifice that will cause others to enjoy freedom? Some of us will have to do some things so others can cross over. Some of us will have to confront some things so that others will not have to deal with that. We have to cross this Jordan. We are at a season, we are in a space and time to where it is time to cross our Jordan. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come. We thank you for this time and your word. We thank you how you have poured out into your people. God, I pray that the ground is good ground. Father, I pray your anointing rest upon us. As we leave this place, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What powerful word and worship we experienced on tonight. And I pray that it blessed your life. But right now, I want to make an appeal to anyone that's watching or may watch later who has not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The Bible says in John chapter 3, verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever, that's me and that's you, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but will have everlasting life. The reason that we are living the life we live today, because we are living to live again. And if you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can spend eternity in paradise with Jesus in peace. The Bible tells us very plainly in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. And so right now, if you want to make that confession and accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want you to repeat after me. Lord God, I am a sinner, but I ask you now, God, to wash me and cleanse me of all of my sins. Forgive me, God, and make me brand new. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he came, he lived, he died, and he rose again just to save me. So Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart to be my Lord and my Savior, and I will be your child. And right now, God, I receive you into my heart. I receive your salvation now. And right now, I am saved. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer in faith, then right now you are saved. Take this time now. Use that link there on the post. Click to connect. Give us your information so that we can get some resources into your hand and get you connected to a supportive group of believers that can help you achieve your goals in God. Also, if you're looking for a church home and the Lord has impressed upon your heart that you're supposed to be a part of the Main Street Church of God in Christ, we want to be your church family. I want to be your pastor. Use that same link. Click to connect. Give us your information and so we can get you connected into ministry where you fit, because there is a place for you right here. We are the church that loves people and we are ready to receive you even now. If you want to sow seed into ministry, use that link. Click to give and you'll be able to be connected to our online secure giving platform, Givelify, and you'll be able to sow seed directly into ministry. We also have Cash App. Use the cash tag $MainStreetCOGIC, and whenever you see our logo in the top left corner, you'll know that you're in the right place. And you can sow seed right now into the ministry of the Main Street Church of God in Christ. Listen, I love you. I thank you so much for tuning in tonight, and we will see you very soon. Our prayer is that God will cover you and keep you until we meet again. And it is so in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to The Lobby, the place to congregate after church. No scripts, no agendas, just fellowship. Join us in The Lobby on Zoom at 1:30 p.m. We'll see you there.